The reading is from Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 8, on 904 in your Bibles if you want to follow along. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.' John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.'" This is the word of God for us this day.
Thanks be to God.
Second Sunday of Advent. This year, our Advent theme is hope, H-O-P-E. Now, I trust that you all know what those four letters mean. H is for what? Hope. O for opportunity. P
for prayer.
E
encouragement.
Encouragement. These four blessings that we as a church had made promise to share with people who come to Hope House.
Amen.
And next Sunday, we are going to have a Hope House Sunday. We are going to listen to update report, and we are going to know about what are the service opportunities for anybody who want to help. And also, we are going to hear what kind of joy all those volunteers are having while they are serving. And last night, we had a wonderful cantata, and that was really a blessing. And if you have not been last night, please come for today at 3 o'clock. That was a message of hope for everybody.
Yes.
The gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And last Sunday we talked about hope. And I said our responsibility as a church is to make this hope of God visible in this world, in
yes.
our communities. How can you make that happen? How can you make the hope of God visible to people in our community and in the world? That is the question that we have to ask. Well, the answer is to give or share the opportunities, the real opportunities for new beginning, new life with people in our community.
Amen.
And especially to those who are coming after us, our next generations.
Yes.
So hope without, you're saying hope, but if you do not share the opportunities, you know, that hope would be only lip service,
right?
Just empty promise. So we have to figure out how to, for us to be able to share or give the real opportunities to people in need. So today's scripture calls for repentance. John the Baptist proclaimed the baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the baptism of repentance is all about new beginning and new opportunities for new life. It's not about the past sins. It's about the future or the present life, current life, about how to start again,
yes,
in a new life. So the meaning of repentance is turning around. Now the meaning is turning around. Turn back and turning around and start a new thing.
Amen.
And the prophet John the Baptist, he calls people to turn around from their own world where God is not the center.
Yeah.
Okay? So when God is not the center, our lives become self-serving and become stuck with the short-sighted agendas.
Wow.
And we become someday spiritually so drained and dried out. And then one day we suddenly realize we are lost in the wilderness. There is no real opportunity if we are stuck in the wilderness. We have to turn around and to come back to God.
Amen.
So have you ever found yourself stuck in the wilderness? No water, no community, no joy, no hope. People of Israel, they had found themselves in the wilderness long time ago.
Yes.
And they had been exiled in Babylon for 70 years. In verse 3, Mark quoted the prophet Isaiah's prophecy that urged people of Israel to prepare for the way of the Lord. And Isaiah tried to awaken them from their sleep so that they can get ready to come back to God. And eventually to the land of their ancestors. After all those 7 years, a rare opportunity was given to them. And, you know, they should have been overjoyed about this. But were they joyful? Were they optimistic for their new lives after all those years? This is a serious question. You know, I've lived now in USA about 27 years. My husband and I had given up our plan to go back to Korea when our children had reached the age of 10, they were born here in the age of 10 or so. We gave up and we realized that we like to live here and my children, they love to live here. And also we realized that it would not be easy for us to go back to Korea and to start all over again.
Well.
Because we had been building up our lives here. And then when we go back, what kind of connection, you know, that are still there. And we had no idea, even though we had some professors and friends over there, but they retired already.
Well.
No power, you know, and we didn't see that possibility, and we just loved living here. So we decided to stay here.
Amen.
Thank you. I'm here. Okay. Think about that. The people of Israel, you know, after 7 years, that was a long time. And they had produced already maybe three generations, right? So not many people had that courage or that willingness to come back, even though they heard the voice of God. According to the record in Ezra chapter 2, verses 64 and the following verses, about 50,000 people had decided to come back. And that number was about 2.5% of the whole population of 2 million people living in Babylon, the people of God, Israelite. So it was only 2.5% of the whole population. They decided to come back. Turning back is not easy. It's never easy. It takes not only courage, but also hard work.
Yes.
Labor, hard labor. Changes require, you know, disciplines and hard labor. It's so hard. Listen to this prayer. Dear God, so far today, I've done all right. I have not gossiped, and I have not lost my temper. I have not been grumpy, nasty, or selfish. It's good. And I am really glad of that. But in a few minutes, God, I am going to get out of bed and from then on, I'm probably going to need a lot of help. Thank you, amen. That's me. You know, facing everyday challenges is not, it is very hard, right?
Yes.
It's hard enough to keep us, you know, wanting to stay in the bed longer in the morning. And imagine that, you know, what kind of challenges the Israelite had to face when they decided to come back. Turning around takes hard work.
Yes.
That's the message today. You know, we all want to turn around for the sake of our children, for the sake of the kingdom of God,
amen.
For the sake of the ministry of Christ.
Yes.
But it takes hard work. And it also takes our vision or purpose for new life. So if you were one of those 2.5% among 2 million people living in Babylon who decided to come back, what would be the reason for which you wanted to come back? What would help you to make decision to come back, knowing that you had to work hard?
Wow.
You had to even sacrifice a lot of things that you
yes.
have known. Well, if you were parents, you would have thought of your children first, right? So you would want your children to have new life and having new opportunities, even if that means a lot of your sacrifice, a lot of your labor. Still, you would wish to see your children living on their own land as free as a sovereign people of God for once.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Not any longer in the land of captives, Babylon. Well, yesterday I heard from one of our church member this story. Some time ago, she happened to pass by her old church in San Francisco. And it was a United Methodist church. But she found out that it was closed a couple of decades ago. It had slowly died for a long time and finally been closed. And she said to me that she felt sad in her heart because that was the church where she was baptized and confirmed and got married.
Amen.
And it was closed. While listening to her, I got sad too. If I would find out my home church in Korea being closed, I would be so sad.
Yes.
And then she said, but I was happy that I found my new church in Brentwood, which is not dying, which is very alive.
Amen.
And active. That was her joy. And then I got happier too. What would we want for our children? We all would want a strong, healthy church community for our children, for our next generations.
Yes.
Because that is the place where true turning around may happen.
Amen.
And thus, new opportunities and new lives can be offered.
Yes.
That is the church community. So even though it was only 2.5% of the whole population in the exile, they chose to come back. And they chose to offer their hard labor for the sake of their next generations. So when they had come back, there were no houses for them. No town people had welcomed them. No one opened their hearts toward these newcomers. They became strangers in their own homeland. They were even persecuted repeatedly, politically, socially, financially. It's
yes.
all written in the book of the Bible. But they did not give up. They had kept giving and working and sacrificing their lives. And they, even in the midst of all those hardships, they found joy in their hearts, in their souls. And they sang happy songs and praises whenever they gathered together and they made songs in the Psalms. And that was a joy of new life.
Amen.
That was joy of new opportunities. That's why we are here for. The joy of turning around compensated over their sacrifice and their labors. So, for this new life and new opportunities, our Lord Jesus Christ had come to us, to this world, offering us new beginning, new life. But he had to labor hard too. He labored hard and sacrificed eventually his life
yes.
for the freedom of God's children.
Amen.
That's why we are here in this church community. So let us join in our Lord Jesus Christ in offering our lives for the sake of our next generations, for this community to be the hope, to be the opportunities so that people can find God and start a new life here.
Amen.
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 Amen. Let us pray. Let us think of the one thing that we might offer or even sacrifice our time or money or our labors in this Christmas season for the sake of our children, for our community. Dear God, thank you for giving this wonderful chance to live for you and to live for our community and our next generations. Lord, help us to find the best way to serve you for the rest of our lives. Thank you for giving this Holy Communion that has been offered by our Lord Jesus Christ for the new opportunity and for the new life. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.